get ready to chart a course through the skies of leadership and aviation history as we welcome a true trailblazer to From the Right Seat. I'm Aaron Slopey Sloper, and today we have the privilege of sitting down with Nancy Kwiecien, the executive officer whose visionary leadership propels the Gulf Coast Wing of the Commemorative Air Force to new heights. Join us as we navigate her incredible journey, the historic aircraft under her care, and the mission to preserve aviation heritage. It's a flight of inspiration you won't want to miss.
Discover the skies like never before on From the Right Seat. Join your host, Slopey, an aircraft mechanic and B-17 loadmaster for Texas Raiders, as we dive into captivating interviews with aviation's finest. Explore the thrilling careers of pilots, air traffic controllers, air show performers, and more, all from the unique perspective of the right seat. Get ready to take off into a world of passion, challenges, and the soaring dreams that define the aviation industry.
Welcome to the From the Right Seat podcast.
Thanks, Aaron. I'm happy to be here.
This is very exciting for me, as we have been friends only for a short time, but it feels like a long time. Can you give the audience some of your background?
I'm the executive officer of the Commemorative Air Force Gulf Coast Wing here in Conroe, Texas. In my previous life, I was a human resources executive. My last role was 16 years with Hewlett-Packard. And my last assignment for them was leading human resources for their IT organization, which meant I had responsibility for IT teams all over the world. I retired from HP about 8 years ago. My husband was already a member of the CAF Gulf Coast Wing.
Okay.
And he encouraged me to join up. So I started doing marketing and public relations for the wing. Then I was doing tour planning for them. And in 2016, I was asked to be the executive officer for the unit, and that's the job I do for them today.
Awesome. And a bang-up job you do.
Thank you, Aaron. That's kind of you. It's a really, really good team that we have. We have a great group at the Gulf Coast.
Yeah. It seems like you're always busy, busy, busy doing something Gulf Coast Wing, and it doesn't go unnoticed.
Thank you. I do keep myself pretty busy, and we're a big unit, and we do a lot of stuff, so there's a lot of things. There's a lot of plates spinning in the air at any given moment.
That's for sure. Can you provide an overview of the Gulf Coast Wing's mission, its significance within the Commemorative Air Force organization?
Sure. So the Commemorative Air Force is a national nonprofit. We have about 12,000 members across the United States, and we maintain a fleet of about 180 World War II aircraft in 65 locations around the U.S., and we even have a couple of units overseas, one in the U.K., one in France. Our mission is to educate, inspire, and honor, is the way we talk about it. We educate the public about the vintage military aircraft and their role in U.S. history. We honor the veterans who flew and maintained them, and we aim to inspire the next generation of aviators. Within each unit, we're charged with driving that mission. The Commemorative Air Force believes that keeping the aircraft flying and bringing them to the public is the best way to accomplish that mission. So we travel with our aircraft. Not only do we show them off here at home in Conroe, but we travel to air shows, to local airports, to civic events, to flyovers, and events like that all over the United States. And we give the public a chance then to truly put their hands on history.
It's truly a flying museum.
It is indeed. We refer to our aircraft as collectively as the Air Power History Museum, in fact. And there really is nothing to compare with taking the real artifact to the public and introducing them to American history.
Just as they were in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, they're the raw power. They're primitive, you know, it was relatively brand new technology back then, and basically it was state of the art to them.
Absolutely. Our aircraft were state of the art at the time that they were built, 75, 80 years ago. And we do bring them to the public exactly as they were. We restore them correctly to their period condition. The only thing that we do to the aircraft to modernize them, of course, is avionics and communication. We fly them with the flight controls that they had, you know, 75 years ago, plus, of course, a little bit of GPS, radios, intercom, and that sort of thing to keep us all safe.
Right.
The Gulf Coast Wing plays a vital role in preserving aviation history. What are some of the key aircraft and artifacts under your care, and how do they contribute to the broader mission of the CAF?
Go. Give me a chance to talk about the airplanes, and just tell me if I run on too long, huh? The Gulf Coast Wing here in Conroe operates two vintage aircraft right now. Since 2016, we've been responsible for the Beechcraft Model 18D, called the Twin Beach for short. In its military configuration, warbird fans would recognize it as a C-45, although it had many roles during World War II. Our Twin Beach was built in 1947, and so although it is a World War II-era aircraft, it did not see military service. One of the most interesting things about the Twin Beach is that it's one of the rare aircraft that enjoyed as much success in the civilian world as it did in the military one. Over 9,000 of these aircraft were produced at Beechcraft Aircraft in Wichita, Kansas, from 1937 all the way till 1970. Making it one of the world's most widely used and longest produced light aircraft. Over the course of that 33 years, Beechcraft Model 18 was produced in a whopping 32 variants.
Wow.
So the Navy and the Army Air Force both used the Beech 18 in multiple roles as a trainer and as a utility transport. During World War II, for example, over 90% of the U.S. Army Air Force bombardiers and navigators trained in those two cases.
All right.
When serving in the Navy, the aircraft was known as the JRB Expediter. And that's how our aircraft is presented today, in crisp navy blue paint and sporting an Admiral's Stars on the side. Today, there are about 250 examples of the Beechcraft Model 18 that are airworthy. And you will see them at air shows, and you'll see them modified in performance. You'll even see the occasionally modified Twin Beach doing aerobatics, which is not what the aircraft is built for.
Correct.
But indeed, you might see one at an air show.
Modified version. Our friend Matt Yonkin.
And the black and red Twin Beach.
Yep.
Absolutely. That aircraft is powered by two Pratt & Whitney 985 Wasp Junior radial engine. So driving 454 horsepower each. It's a powerful little twin-engine airplane.
Mm-hmm.
If, for example, you were an aspiring bomber pilot in World War II, you would move to the Twin Beach to start your multi-engine training.
Mm.
So that aircraft did a lot of different jobs in World War II.
Mm-hmm.
The Commemorative Air Force Gulf Coast Wing also operates the 1942 North American T-6. So it is an aircraft. We're very, very proud of it. It is a true World War II veteran. The AT-6 Advanced Trainer, one of the most recognized aircraft from World War II, both then and now.
And not by just sight, but sound as well.
Not by sight, but also by sound. You can hear them coming for sure. Regardless of the service branch, during the war, virtually all aspiring U.S. airmen had to master the North American T-6 before they got their pilot's wings. The accelerated wartime training regimen from start to finish, from I've never sat in an airplane to ready for combat, was 7 months and included just 200 flight hours for pilots who were going into combat. Of that 200 hours, the final 75 were typically logged in the T-6 Advanced Trainer, nicknamed the T-6 Texan.
Mm-hmm.
Designated in AT-6 in the Army, the Navy, because it's the Navy, I had to call it something else. So if it served in the Navy, it's called an SNJ.
Right.
And the Gulf Coast Wings aircraft is an SNJ. Universally known, whatever branch you were headed for, the T-6 was called the pilot maker.
Very much so.
As an advanced trainer, it wasn't particularly easy to fly by intention.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a basic trainer anymore. It was an advanced trainer. Once achieving his pilot's wings in the T-6, the U.S. airman would continue on to assignment in his combat aircraft. If you were training in an SNJ like ours, your next stop would have been carrier training. And then you'd have been headed across the Pacific. Our aircraft served with distinction during World War II, providing instrument training at Pensacola Naval Air Station in the last 18 months of the war. And she's painted today in the same livery that she wore in World War II. Bright green stripes identifying the Marine Corps instrument trainer. She was assigned to several different Naval Air Intermediate Training units towards the latter couple of years of the war. The T-6 Texans were very popular. They production was continued through 1952, over 15,000 of them manufactured. It's a single engine advanced trainer, has a 1340 Wasp radial, delivers 600 horsepower on that aircraft. So in our unit here in the Gulf Coast Wing, we're all about radial engines.
Mm-hmm.
And we service, maintenance team services, three engines in our hangar with our two aircraft.
Awesome. As the executive director, what inspired you to become involved with the CAF Gulf Coast Wing and take on a leadership role in preserving vintage aircraft and aviation heritage?
Oh, it's a funny story. Because, I joke about, I actually really could barely spell aviation when I stumbled across the Commemorative Air Force, and that's because my husband wanted to join up.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember really well the day that Dennis went down to the CAF for the first time. And he came home with this big, stupid smile on his face. And he said, "They'll teach me. They'll teach me. And they go places. And if I volunteer and work, I can go with them. I can go with them on an airplane." And he was over the moon. And I was still working then. Later, I retired. And he said, "You really need to come down and do this stuff. Many of our members are inspired by the aircraft and by flight. And the aircraft light me up, too. But I'm also very fascinated by the history and particularly by the stories of the veterans who operate the aircraft and their roles in American history.
Mm-hmm.
These stories are at risk of being lost. And I consider that an important part of our mission to help save some of that history.
Mm-hmm.
I can't tell you how uplifting it is to stand next to an aircraft and witness the impact on a veteran's family member, for example, as you tell them that they can stand where Dad stood, or they can sit where Grandpa sat, and understand maybe for the first time what it really meant for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's worthy work.
Mm-hmm.
And so those are the things that inspired me to join up in the beginning. You mentioned leadership role. I took on greater responsibilities because I was retired then and I had the time and there was a great need. There is always a great need in the volunteer organizations. Mm-hmm. Here comes a plug for volunteers. And we'll talk more about that in a minute, but we always need help. And I found that I could apply a lot of my work experience in leading teams than in the Gulf Coast Wing.
Mm-hmm.
I also discovered how very, very different it is to lead in a volunteer organization where all the members are there for different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
There's nobody there for the paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's polishing their resume, climbing the corporate ladder. They're really all there for different reasons. And that's an entirely different leadership environment for somebody who wants to lead a team. It's been an amazing learning experience for me, not what I expected. I did not expect this to be a development opportunity for me, but indeed it has turned out to be a great development for me personally to lead in this organization. I also think if it's the case in most volunteer organizations, it is true that we get more than we give.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I've gotten a lot out of it.
Could you share some of the recent accomplishments or notable initiatives of the Gulf Coast Wing, particularly in terms of aircraft restoration, educational programs, or community outreach?
Boy, we've done a lot in the time I've been in our unit, which is relatively short in the history of the Gulf Coast Wing. I didn't talk about the history of our unit, but the Gulf Coast Wing is over 50 years old and has always been housed here in Southeast Houston, in the greater Houston area, Southeast Texas. So I've been here 10 years. In that time, I think one of the best accomplishments of our unit in the last few years has been to extend our reach and engagement across the Commemorative Air Force. It was typical in the past that the various units worked more or less independently, planning their own appearances, planning their own travel, and kind of working on their own. The Gulf Coast Wing developed a methodology where, as one of the larger units, we could take the lead in planning and execution for a given event and invite multiple units to join up with us, whether we were going barnstorming, which is what we call it when we take a bunch of airplanes to an airport near you, or fly-ins and air shows. So more warbirds is better, right, at any given moment. So it's a big win-win for everyone because the event host gets to have more aircraft at his or her event whilst that person deals with a single point of contact, meaning the Gulf Coast Wing. The units collectively get more exposure. Smaller units get the advantage of being with bigger units. And we gain economies of scale then for bigger and better events that in turn bring out more fans. So I think that work, that connecting, working to connect the units together using that business model, has had a big benefit. Internally, we refer to it as the flying circus model. As in, we're going to bring the flying circus to a town near you. It's been very successful. It also leads, I think, to good camaraderie and a cross-pollinization of good practices across the units, too. Mm-hmm.
The Gulf Coast Wing engages with the public and aviation enthusiasts in various ways. How do you foster a sense of connection and enthusiasm among members, volunteers, and the broader community?
Sense of connection. Connection amongst the unit and connections between us and the fans and the community is completely changed as a result of social media. 10 years ago when I joined, there wasn't anything like a social media environment. We kind of sort of had a Facebook page.
Mm-hmm.
Since then, social media has exploded, and we've leveraged that hard. We've leveraged that a lot. Our unit hired a professional social media company back in 2015. So we've had a tremendous amount of success engaging our fan base by sharing not only what we're doing in public, but also we share looks behind the scenes, as it were. We look at maintenance, we look at performances, we look at training, we show off kind of what happens behind the curtain.
Mm-hmm.
And in that way, our fans learn more about what we do. They learn about us, but they also get to see things that maybe they might not see otherwise. NetWeave Social, the company that we use, has really been a big driving force to help us with that strategy for connectivity. And in a month with high engagement, I'm not blowing smoke at you, in a month with high engagement, we might reach 1 million fans.
Wow.
With
that's impressive.
A hot Facebook and Instagram together. Using the technology to stay connected has turned out to be very important to us and to the crew, right? So we have other connectivity tools that we use as a crew, and we can talk quickly and easily among ourselves to help us stay tightly together. We don't all live in the same town. All of our members don't even all live in Texas.
Right, yeah.
So the connectivity tools has given us the opportunity to stay tighter as a crew. And when you're constantly recruiting and constantly looking for more help, being able to communicate quickly and easily has been a big, big advantage.
Aircraft maintenance and restoration are essential aspects of preserving aviation history. What challenges and successes has the Gulf Coast Wing experienced in maintaining and restoring vintage aircraft?
Challenges and, and successes. We have a really excellent maintenance team, and they are dedicated to serving and supporting the aircraft, and they are good at what they do. In addition to professional qualifications and training, there is a ton of tribal knowledge, if you will. We were talking about that, you and me, a little bit earlier. Yeah. There's what's in the book, and then there's what everybody, learns on the job. There's a lot of that kind of tribal knowledge associated with working on 75-year-old airplanes. Is there new old stock? You know what new old stock is, right? It's old because it was manufactured 75 years ago, but it's still new in its spot.
Mm-hmm.
There is such a thing as new old stock. Is there new old stock to be had somewhere? What's the last time another unit did similar repairs or restorations? All of this kind of, I call it tribal knowledge, is hugely valuable to us in keeping the airplane running, and that is part of the success story. The warbird industry has a tremendous network of very skilled and experienced people, and they do specialize in this particular slice, if you will, of the aviation industry. We get asked all the time, how do you do maintenance and how do you get parts for the old airplanes? Well, sometimes we do get new old stock. Sometimes there is a lot of reconditioned and rebuilt stock, which is something we rely on a lot. And if all else fails, then we fabricate something and we figure it out. One of the biggest strategic challenges, he's asked what are challenges and what are successes. One of the biggest strategic challenges is how to maintain in top flying condition a 75-year-old aircraft that was designed to have a lifespan of maybe a year. What does metallurgy tell us? What does operating the aircraft in a completely different way than what it was designed for? What do we learn from that in terms of maintaining, keeping the airplanes flying? That is a really big challenge. And I think I get to turn that over and say it's also a really big success for us because we are operating the airplanes very successfully 75 years
later. We're doing it.
We're doing it. We're doing it in good shape. They fly well. They fly safely. And they're doing the jobs, well, exactly maybe the job they were designed to do.
Right.
But all of our aircraft are operating well, and that's a testament to the work that the CAF does.
And it's a lot of fun, too.
Not to mention, oh my gosh, how much fun is it to climb into the back seat of a 75-year-old aircraft, pull a headset on, and pull on your gloves, and zoom off into the sky. It's big, big fun.
The CAF has a strong educational component. How does the Gulf Coast Wing contribute to educating the public about aviation history, and what programs or resources do you offer to achieve this?
When we talk about education, I have to point to the cadet program. Our cadet program in the CAF overall is really important to us. It's similar to other aviation organizations like the Civil Air Patrol and the EAA in that, you know, we're aimed at youth and we're aimed at aviation. A whole piece of the Commemorative Air Force is dedicated to youth. In our case, the focus is, of course, on the vintage aircraft and on their history as well. We partner with the Commemorative Air Force headquarters to participate in a brand new scholarship program, too. So in addition to the work that cadets can do with us, cadets can join our organization. And as a cadet, if you're between the ages of 12 and 18, you can do activities with the unit right alongside the adults. We have adult supervision, and we're careful about how we manage our youth. But they get to do things that otherwise, you know, kids wouldn't necessarily get to do. And in addition to being able to participate in maintaining the aircraft and hosting events and learning how to marshal aircraft on the ramp under supervision and that sort of thing, we also, the CAF has launched a new scholarship program. And the scholarship program, which we're partnered with the James Ray Foundation, actually pays for the formal flight training of college students who are studying aviation and who are active members in our cadet program.
Wow.
And so inspiring the next generation of aviators is an important part of our mission, and not only for our organization, but for the aviation industry, too, which needs pilots and needs mechanics.
Community engagement and support are often crucial for nonprofit organizations. How do you cultivate partnerships and secure resources to sustain the Gulf Coast Wing's operations and objectives?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because it's all about resources for us. We're a 501c3 nonprofit. Fans sometimes assume we get government subsidy to help maintain the historic military aircraft. That is not the case. All of our funding comes from donations, from membership dues, and the revenue that we generate selling merchandise and flights on the aircraft. So while we're an educational organization at heart, we do have to run like a business, and we have to keep our eyes on ways to generate revenue effectively and efficiently. And truthfully, if it wasn't for all of the donated labor that runs this organization, the maintenance and the business operations would not be possible to do what we do. So community partnerships take the form of sponsorships, especially like-kind donations of services. Oftentimes we have to contract for work on the aircraft we can't do ourselves. Non-destructive testing, which involves x-rays, is one example. Fancy welding might be another. Donations of that kind of labor are very valuable to us. Payments to appear with the aircraft, appearance fees, are a way that we generate revenue. And we love to do flyovers for our community organizations. So if you're in the Southeast Texas area and you're listening, commemorativeairforce.org for flyovers, pretty much anywhere in Texas or in the United States. Our biggest source of revenue, though, is the Living History Flight Experience Program, where our fans can purchase flights in the vintage aircraft. Our flying season is generally from April to November. Any fan who's interested in flying with us can go to our website and see what events are coming up. As you and I record this, we're approaching the end of our flying season for 2023. So it's time for us to start thinking about next year. But purchasing flights in the aircraft is the biggest way that we keep them flying. Every dollar, whether it's donated or a purchase of a ride or a purchase of a hat or a t-shirt, every single dollar goes back into the organization after we pay for fuel and buying the product, right? So it's a constant effort to generate and gain resources.
So I think this next question is one of the questions that I presented to you to make you say yes to this interview, because we were discussing, you know, what this interview is going to be like. Can you discuss some things of behind the scenes? And you, I remember you saying, you know, that's a really good idea. That's a really good question, because a lot of people just see us pull up on the ramp and get out of a bomber, get out of a JRB, get out of a Texan, you know, and just show up and set things up and start selling T-shirts. But nobody has any clue what goes on behind the scenes. So having said that, what are some behind the scenes secrets and logistics to deal with to be able to hold a large aviation event or make an appearance and fly an event, not even a large aviation event, but a barnstorming or fly-in.
Right.
It takes a great deal of logistics.
Yes, and your description is apt. And that's such a fun part of what we do, is to arrive at an event, and you know, the airplanes roll up, and maybe the fans are already up against the fence waiting for us.
Phones are in the air.
Right, everybody's smiling and pointing, and you know, these guys climb out of the airplanes in their flight suits and their cool sunglasses, and boy, do we look good. And it takes a ton of work behind the scenes to make that all happen at that moment in time that you see on Facebook. You know, our planning starts typically a year in advance for any kind of event. And the planning and the logistics of fitting together a year-long schedule efficiently and cost-effectively takes a whole team of people. If there's a secret to doing this work effectively, it's to start early. And you know, I say that and I expect to see you giggle, because we always seem to be running behind and we always seem to be in a hurry. But in the volunteer organization, everything takes longer than you think. So getting planning done early is a key. Clear roles, clear goals. Who's going to do what for who by when? And that's where the operational expertise comes to play. Because you have to be clear on that to work effectively and make any organization run effectively. People have to know what's expected of them. At the end of the day, though, there's really nothing that substitutes just for experience. I joked earlier when I joined the CAF, I couldn't hardly spell aviation. So I learned on the job. At big events, there's everything from, you know, scheduling multiple stops for a big trip. For example, you know, the team would be saying to each other, well, if we go to the Terre Haute Air Show on this date and then we want to go to Wichita on that date, maybe we could squeeze in St. Louis somewhere in between so that we get the biggest bang for our fuel buck. There's ramp planning that has to happen every time the airplanes arrive anywhere. And hey, don't let the T-shirt tent get too close to the prop wash. And crowd control, from everything from, you know, what we're going to do with all the people down to the requirements like, what's the airport policy on firearms again? Managing the media. No, sorry, your reporter can't take the controls of the airplane. So sorry. mundane operations like fueling. You know, nope, that's not the aircraft's end number. That's a military serial number. Those aren't the same thing. there is a huge amount of planning in advance that has to happen. Another key tool for us in terms of planning and successfully planning is data management. And this is something that the Gulf Coast Wing has done a good job of, too. Operational data. How much fuel do the airplanes burn? How often do you have to address the consumables, like brake pads, tires, financial data. What did we earn at that city last time? What might we earn at that city next time? Future looking forecasting. And the Gulf Coast Wing has gotten pretty good at that, so that we can tell if a particular plan is likely to be financially successful or not. And all of that work, as I said, has to happen well in advance. As you get closer to an event, you know, then you're dealing with stuff like media and interviews and crew schedules and, you know, the unexpected maintenance hiccups. And so all of that means that you just have to be able to be very flexible. I actually have a graphic I should send to you. It's a Gumby all twisted up in circles. And our slogan is Semper Gumby. Have to be flexible.
And not to mention everybody, well, not everybody, but most of our pilots still have jobs.
Oh, sure.
They still have families, you know, and that's another another feat that we have to go through. And when we do go on the road, we're on the road for anywhere from, you know, we can be on the road for 3 days, upwards of 20, 30 days that we've done before.
That's right.
And we have to, you know, keep going through, okay, who can do what, where can this pilot come from to go, and then they can pick up a leg here to go there, turn around, come back, and they fly a plane again for us.
Right. You know, don't forget, you have to be sure that you've got the right pilots rated in the right airplanes, and there's always extra requests. Can we fly this formation?
Mm-hmm.
That pilot rated for formation flying? He might not be. Can we substitute somebody else? We could make some more money if we could do a formation flight. Well, if we make this pilot fly that leg instead of the other one, and if he plans some vacation days in advance for those days, then we could have him meet us in this city, but only if he can get a ride on a different warbird that's coming from some other air show where he already has a commitment. That is exactly what the pilot schedule looks like.
It's almost like you've gone through that before.
We do have to scramble sometimes to fill all those seats, that's for sure.
Yeah. Aviation history is a continually evolving field. How do you see the Gulf Coast Wing's role evolving in the future? And are there any new initiatives or projects on the horizon that you can share with us?
Evolving.
Sure.
We would like to be a bigger unit.
Mm-hmm.
So that might be something we'd like to look forward to in the future. We love the city of Conroe. We'd like to stay here. It's a double-edged sword. We love this community. The community loves us. And we have a great fan base here and a good crew here, too. The challenge is, of course, it's one of the fastest-growing cities in the United States. And that's resources are a little more scarce for us because everything is in demand, and thus that drives costs up.
Mm-hmm.
So that's to get bigger, you know, you got to have the resources behind you and a financial solid plan to do that. Would we like to acquire another airplane? I know there's lots of folks now who'd like us to acquire another airplane, and in fact, we have a task force that's operating right now that's asking the questions, if we were to acquire another airplane, what might we acquire? That is a long and complicated set of variables to analyze, but it is something that we aspire to,
mm-hmm.
is to be bigger.
Kind of focusing on the Gulf Coast Wing, how many members do we have, and do you happen to know off the top of your head how many members are here in Texas, how many are branched out? I know I can name a couple off the top of my head. But...
right. We have 185 members on the books. As in most volunteer organizations, you know, the number of people who are actively and routinely engaged is much smaller than that. Can I tell how many are inside and outside of Texas? I'd say, you know, if you look at the whole 180, we do have a fair amount of members who are, I would consider to be financial supporting members.
Right.
We don't expect them to show up at the hangar on Saturday in Conroe,
mm-hmm.
because they're in Pittsburgh, or they're in Pensacola, or they're in Denver, or they're in Terre Haute.
Mm-hmm.
We do have people scattered around. Maybe that's 10%.
Okay.
And the membership of people who are really scattered outside of Texas, and then there's inside of Texas, but not in Montgomery County or close at hand.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a pretty sizable chunk of folks who are not particularly close at hand, but who will turn up and support on an as-needed basis.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's time for the big air show down at Ellington Field, that's all hands on deck, and people show up from, and they come from far and near,
mm-hmm.
because we need everybody.
Mm-hmm.
On a given Tuesday, when it's time to change out a worn-out tire, you know, then those folks will be the ones who live here in Conroe, mm-hmm. who show up to do maintenance on a regular basis.
And not to mention, our group is very diverse. But it doesn't matter where we came from. It doesn't matter what we do or our religious beliefs, our political beliefs. We're all there for one goal, and that's to support the CAF. That's to... educate, inspire, and honor.
And that's an important observation. We do have people from tremendously diverse backgrounds, blue collar, white collar. We have some young people. We have some not so very young people. We have a couple of World War II veterans, one most particularly who is actually active with us and comes out to our events. A man's 102. And we have a handful of cadets. The youngest is like 14.
Mm-hmm.
People who are still working for a living. We have people who are retired. People who have lots of resources at hand and some with less so. But they still turn up to support the mission. And I had somebody mentioned to me, actually asked me one time, devotion, Nancy, where does that devotion come from? And I guess it comes from different places for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
But the folks who work hard for the unit are devoted to the mission.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the thing that's in common.
For those individuals interested in supporting or getting involved with the CAF Gulf Coast Wing, what opportunities are available and what would you recommend to those looking to make a meaningful contribution to the preservation of aviation heritage?
There are lots of ways to support the CAF. Anyone who's interested should first join the Commemorative Air Force. Once again, that's the national organization headquartered in Dallas. We ask for membership dues of $225 a year to join the national organization. And then members can affiliate with any unit or as many numbers of units as they choose to. And in fact, in our organization, we have quite a few of our members who belong to multiple units, some more active with them than others. But once you're a member of the CAF at the national level, then any fan can express an interest to support any of the units. Someone who would like to support us here in Conroe would find us at gulfcoastwing.org. And there's lots of information on our website there about how to join and a little bit about the organization and what we do. Typical opportunities that we have for people to engage include actually working on the airplanes. Nope, you don't have to have a mechanics license to do it. And in fact, there is plenty of work that is not necessarily required to be highly mechanical in kind, because we do a lot of cleaning. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of cleaning of parts. We do a lot of inventory work. We do a lot of parts management. And there's always something that can be done in the hangar.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're interested in getting dirty here, there's no limit to the amount of oil and grease you can get on you if you'd like to come out to the hangar. We also have a lot of administrative roles. We have a pretty sophisticated financial operation, as you might guess, from selling T-shirts and selling rides. We have marketing and public relations work that we do. And we have a need for tour planning work, which are the people who would be in on the front lines of the planning that I mentioned a little bit ago, the people who would be contacting airports or working with air shows to determine what their needs are and whether or not we can come to their event successfully. So all of those roles are things that we would love to see more people helping with. We do need pilots. We need pilots who are already familiar with the kind of airplanes that we fly. In the aviation world, they talk about them as tail draggers. That means the old airplanes have a tail wheel underneath the tail of the airplane. The tail wheel aircraft requires a particular endorsement from the FAA. And if you want to fly with us, then a tail wheel endorsement and some time in a tail dragging airplane is something that we'd like to see. And if you want to fly people for a living, then we need to talk about things like commercial pilot's licensing and that sort of thing. But that doesn't mean you can't be crew if you're not a pilot, because some of our airplanes require crew to go with them. There's a job in our unit called crew chief, and the crew chief is a maintenance person who learns the basics of maintenance on the aircraft, like how to put fuel on it and how to check the tires and how to check the oil. And those people travel with the airplanes. So if you want to get out and go to air shows with us, you can train to be a crew chief. If you want to go out and travel to events with us, you can also sell T-shirts and hats, as we also have a big merchandise operation, and that needs support as well. That's inventory control, that's pick, pack, and ship, all of those things. So you can see there are lots of different roles inside the organization. We always need help with all of them. GulfCoastWing.org, press the join button. Or you can send us an email. And if you click the email button on our website at GulfCoastWing.org, you'll send an email to our staff and you can just ask some questions. And hey, we can hang out, come out to the airport sometime, just see us, shake our hands, look at the airplanes and see what we're all about.
No commitment requirements.
No, not at all. And the amount of time that our volunteers invest varies tremendously mm-hmm. with each individual. People who are working for a living and raising families and that, you know, maybe they can only contribute a little bit here and there. That's great. Mm-hmm. Folks like me who are retired and they can contribute more, well, come learn some stuff and, mm-hmm. and maybe aspire to a staff level position.
Mm-hmm. But the most important thing, there's no experience required.
Absolutely not.
Just a love of aviation and a love, not even just aviation, but wanting to dedicate some time to the veterans that of the greatest generation.
Right. Absolutely. If you're interested in American history and you're interested in the intersection of aviation and American history, boy, it's big fun. I will tell you a story about our former wing leader who was very devoted to aviation, youth in aviation, and American history in aviation. And it kind of didn't matter how far behind we were at any given event. If you were going to fly with us, you would hear the story that he told about the man who came to see us with his father, who toured the airplanes with us, and then went home and came back the next day, grabs a hold of the wing leader, gives him a big hug, tears in his eyes, and says, thank you, thank you, thank you. My father would never talk to us about his World War II service, but I brought him out here to see the airplanes, and when we went home last night, he talked for 3 hours. And we laughed and we cried, and then he said, it's time to go to bed. I'm tired. We won't talk about this again. And the son said to us the only time that his father ever spoke to him about his service, and he would have lost all of that. He wouldn't have known any of what his father did, except for he came to see the Commemorative Air Force mm-hmm. and connect with the airplanes. So to me, that's a lot of why we do what we do and why we fly.
There's such a special connection there.
Yeah.
Would you like to share yours and or the Wing's social with the audience?
Sure. Yeah, you can find us everywhere. It's just GulfCoastWing.org. On Facebook, CAF, Gulf Coast Wing. We're on Insta, GulfCoastWing.org. We have a very active Facebook page. I was on the phone this morning with our Facebook and Instagram social manager. We're at 110,000 fans, active fans on those pages. You can find us there. We're pretty active. So if you want to see what we're doing, find us on social media. GulfCoastWing.org.
Awesome.
We have so much fun.
Yeah, we do.
We really do have a... This weekend, a couple of our pilots, some of our crew were out actually with other units. I mm-hmm. talked about cross-pollinating other units. And I was seeing pictures going by on their social pages. And one of them was out the window of a warbird looking at the Grand Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm cool. typing back comments. I'm so jealous.
So final question, one that we've discussed before. Almost at length, Derek. So I love baseball, and the batter walks up to the box to a segment of a song. If you had a walk-up song to an airplane, to the tent, to any event anywhere in the country, what would that song be?
Well, if you're talking about my 1940s alter ego, it would have to be Sing, Sing, Sing by Benny Goodman. So let's get up tempo and go. Nobody can sit still when Betty Goodman plays.
So like Nancy said, if you'd like to get more information, GulfCoastWing.org, CAF, Gulf Coast Wing on Facebook and Instagram. If you want to come out and hang out with us, we would love to have you. Me personally, obviously, I am part of the Gulf Coast Wing. I am a crew chief, and my time with the Gulf Coast Wing and the CAF as a whole has been life-altering. It has been amazing. Moved here 2 years ago. Looking for something to do, and I didn't think I'd find my family, my Texas family, and I certainly did. So, this has been Slow P with Nancy Kwiecien, the Executive Officer of the Gulf Coast Wing, and until next time, fly high.
Thanks, Aaron.
All right, what an interview. Thank you to Nancy Kwiecien from the Gulf Coast Wing of the Commemorative Air Force. Like she said, if you want to get a hold of them or you want to join the Commemorative Air Force, even the Gulf Coast Wing, wherever you're listening this podcast, there is a ton of information on commemorativeairforce.org. Go on there, click the join button, search the local wing to your location, and don't hesitate to make a donation. Like she said, every dollar that you donate goes right back to the warbirds that we fly and that we keep history flying. I wanted to take this time to thank you for clicking on this podcast named From the Right Seat. I'm your host, Slopey, and it's been a pleasure sitting with you for the last 45 to 50 minutes of your day. I hope you check out more episodes coming in the future. Check us out on the socials. Like, subscribe. There's more to come. As we prepare for landing, remember to keep your dreams aloft. From one aviation enthusiast to another, this is From the Right Seat, signing off. Until our next flight, blue skies and tailwinds.